Hello, everybody. Thank you for inviting me to ZKM. It's really, really great to be here again after a couple of years. It was always and will always be my favorite workplace. It's really good to see new faces and old faces, old friends. And I'm really, really happy to be here. So my task today is to think loudly with you. The first ideas for my talk today that I had with Livia and Felix about the topic involved reflecting on the topic of gamification in the context of exhibitions, museology, curatorial practice, and of course art history and media history. Gamification is a relatively new concept that refers to the application of game design principles and mechanics to non-game contexts, such as education or business. In essence, gamification is meant to enhance user motivation and engagement by introducing elements that tap into the psychological factors that underlie an individual's desire to play. The theoretical framework for gamification is based largely on self-determination theory and the concept of intrinsic versus extrinsic motivation. Self-determination theory posits that people have three basic psychological needs: autonomy, competence, and relatedness. Gamification seeks to fulfill these needs through mechanisms such as feedback, rewards, and social interaction. At its core, gamification involves the use of game mechanics and design principles to create game-like experiences in non-game contexts. And this can be accompanied using a range of different techniques such as point systems, leaderboards, badges, leveling systems, among others. The same applies to the area of so-called serious games. Serious games, also known as applied games or gamification for positive impact, are gaming applications that have been designed to achieve an educational, social, or behavioral goal. They are interactive, engaging, and they try to be fun, but also incorporate game design elements and mechanics to encourage users to learn or adopt specific behaviors. Serious games are often developed in collaboration with experts from various fields such as education, psychology, healthcare, ecology, and so on and so forth. And they can be used in a wide range of contexts, including education, training, marketing, health, wellness, and of course social activism and propaganda and politics and so on. Critics refer to the psychological tricks that are enabling gamification as chocolate-covered broccoli. Gamification, especially in the context of business, in my opinion, is a symptom of late capitalism, and this is not what my focus should be today. Therefore, my approach has shifted a bit, and today I would like to talk from the perspective of art history and media theory about computer games and playful interactions that we have encountered in the broader context of curatorial practice as artworks rather than gamified artifacts, such as the toothbrush that you have seen. As we will see, playful interaction is deeply inscribed in the DNA of ZKM and is deeply inscribed into the DNA of media art in general. For the purpose of structuring my talk today, I have formed two rather robust chapters that are video games as exhibits and video games as exhibitions. Let's see what I mean by that. The history of the computer game begins in a specific situation that is interestingly resembles an exhibition. It all began with the misuse or abuse of an oscilloscope in 1958 when physicist William Higginbotham combined this electronic measuring device with an analog computer to create a tennis game called Tennis for Two. He developed the game, its interface, and the type of installation for the Brookhaven National Laboratory's open house, für den Tag der offenen Tür, when the public was invited to visit the research facility. The Brookhaven National Laboratory, BNL, is a vast scientific research facility located in Upton, Long Island, New York, that is operated by the United States Department of Energy. I assume that it was not his intention to invent a new media genre and cultural practice, but rather to provide his visitors with an interesting and exciting way to engage with technology. In this sense, Tennis for Two was primarily a didactic artifact that served to mediate and communicate with its users, a serious game of some sort. Since the early 1970s, the computer game as a product has been institutionalized and commercialized by the computer game industry. Interestingly, computer games have always existed as exhibits as well as technically sophisticated installations in public spaces. Before the new medium penetrated the privacy of living rooms in the form of video consoles and personal computers and so on, computer game machines could be played in so-called arcades via coin-operated machines. What we see here is an arcade cabinet from 1985 called Hang On by the Japanese company Sega. The recipient sits on this fully movable model of the motorcycle while playing, and the screen is directly integrated into this construction to enhance the immersion. Arcade culture still exists today, of course, and borrows heavily from concepts that have been tested in the context of media art and experimental technology, and vice versa. The setups, constellations, constructions, and ultimately dispositives tested there also shaped early media art. Jeffrey Shaw's The Legible City from 1989 is a seminal classic piece from the ZKM collection that everybody knows here in the audience, I assume. It consists of a stationary bicycle in a computer-generated virtual city, for example, Karlsruhe, New York, that can be explored by pedaling the bike. As the user navigates the virtual city, text and images are projected onto the walls around them, creating a dynamic multimedia experience. The Legible City consists of large projection screens that display a virtual cityscape, a seemingly endless grid of streets and buildings. The user is provided with a stationary bicycle as an interface that is mounted on a pedestal, which serves as the interface for exploring the virtual environment. Discussing Jeffrey Shaw's artwork, The Legible City, Heinrich Klotz, the founding director of ZKM, referred to Johann Heusinger's seminal book Homo Ludens. He said, and this is a German quote now, "Und das Ganze hat etwas Spielerisches. Das Kunstwerk ist wie das Spiel geworden, der Mensch ein Homo Ludens. The whole thing has something playful about it. The artwork has again become a game and man has become man the player, Homo Ludens." Klotz makes a clear distinction between two modes of the artwork, which require two specific forms of reception. One, seeing static images and acting, secondly, with moving images. He says, "Falling silent in admiration when confronted with a pure act of seeing recedes in the face of the joy of discovering and acting when presented with the invitation to engage in interactivity. One crosses the border into the realm of play. One enjoys the freedom of an intellectual and sensual game. Interaction is never the quiet of contemplation, but always the moving image, action, playing with changing the parameters within limited possibilities." And this is a quote from 1997, I think. Numerous exhibitions since 1999 have been devoted to the products of artistic engagement with video games. Many internationally renowned artists have created works that refer to video games or that are video games. The Australian art historian Jason Wilson traced a media archaeological line from Namjoon Paik's TV artworks to early computer games such as Pong. They were created at around the same time, and they also share the same zeitgeist informed by technological utopianism in the context of the 60s and 70s. This evidences the historical connection between digital games and interactive media art. In an essay published in 2009, Sücke Dinkler also linked video games and interactive media art, assigned them to different contexts, entertainment industry versus art world, and referred to them as an ungleiches Geschwisterpaar, dissimilar siblings. Interactive media art clearly belongs to the realm of art, whereas video games exist in the context of the entertainment industry. However, artists have now transferred video games to the art system context, utilizing various strategies. And today, there are art computer games that fall into the category of interactive media art as well as the category of video games. In her book, Das systemische Bild, Inge Hinterwaldner remarks, again a German quote, diese Trennung in Computerspiele einerseits und interaktive Kunst andererseits lässt sich heute nicht mehr aufrechterhalten, da es künstlerische Computerspiele gibt. This division into interactive media art on the one side and video games on the other is no longer sustainable because there are now art video games. This is to wake you up after this theoretical remarks, and we see here a very cute little game. The affinities between computer games and media art and those different contexts are particularly evident in the work of Toshio Iwai. Toshio Iwai made this game called Otoki in 1987. This video footage we just saw shows some gameplay from the game. It is one of the first video games that I am aware of that is designed by a media artist. It is important to state, however, that Otoki is clearly situated in the context of the entertainment industry and outside the art world. It is still a great example for pushing boundaries and blurring lines, considering the connection between video games and art. The game that we see here is a side-scrolling shooter and contains generative music, meaning the soundtrack is being generated by playing the game in the first place. It's a musical instrument of some sort. The music and sound effects are dependent on the player's actions and the way she is interacting with the rule set of the game and the algorithms of the computer program. The topic of generative music and sound is the main theme in Toshio Iwai's body of work. He varied the theme in almost all of his pieces. Iwai was an artist in resident at ZKM, by the way, in 1994, and he did variations on the theme that are visible on this slide. His large-scale interactive installations like Piano as Image Media are targeted on synesthesial effects, mainly the interplay of visual and auditive sensations. And these proven concepts from the realm of media art are included in commercial yet experimental video games by Toshio Iwai, for example, SimTunes from 1996, and Electroplankton here from 2005 for a Nintendo console. Iwai's body of work emphasizes that interactive media art and video games are extremely closely related but are happening in different contexts, the art world and the entertainment industry. Let us now explore together how the environment of a computer game can itself become a kind of exhibition. So we enter chapter two now. Computer games have the property or the quality of opening up spaces. They show us spatial configurations and are themselves experienced as spaces. And this is the starting point for thinking about how games themselves can become exhibition spaces. My example for a video game in art history and a kind of game exhibition hybrid is the artistic video game modification Ars Doom from 1995. 1995, the Austrian architect Orhan Kipchak was commissioned by Peter Weibel At that time, he was artistic director of Ars Electronica, and he produced an interactive piece for the festival. The result was Ars Doom, a video game modification that is based on Doom 2. Maybe you know the video game Doom. It's a first-person shooter, and interestingly, the engine was open source, so they artists could use it for their own pieces. They used this IT Tech 1 engine that he designed with his colleague Reinhard Urban. Ars Doom is a digitally constructed model of the Bruckner House in Linz. This is the venue where Ars Electronica took place in 1995. The replica was constructed with the help of the original blueprints of the Bruckner House. So this is it's a model of the exhibition space. Players navigate the spatial structures of the game. There, they encounter giant heads coming closer to the players. And these monsters are the portraits of artists who were part of Ars Electronica. Peter Weibel can be seen in the game too, by the way. That's him. The weapons, it's a first-person shooter, though, so you have to have weapons, right? And the weapons in this first-person shooter refer to artists from recent art history. For example, players can shoot with Namjoon Paik's TV remote, or they can use Josef Beuys' cross, he has some crucifix, or they use Arnold Reiner's thumb. This game is about entering and penetrating the structures of Ars Electronica as an institution of art, standing for the art world system. Players become iconoclasts and destroy artworks and artists alike in the iconography of a first-person shooter. Kipchak commented on the aggressive impetus of the piece, and he said, "I chose those artists because they were well-known and their art had a brutal aspect to it. This is important for an ego shooter, first-person shooter. With Arnold Reiner, you paint over artworks. With Hermann Nitsch, you soak them in blood. And with Baselitz, you turn them upside down." So you could shoot at the pictures on the wall and flip them upside down, or you can cross them with pig's blood, representing Hermann Nitsch's oeuvre. This game, of course, is an inside joke, a tongue-in-cheek take on the art world. The theme of entering and penetrating a system is multi-layered in the piece. First of all, the players invade the space of Ars Electronica. Secondly, Ars Doom creators Kipchak and Urban entered the very structures of the software Doom 2 in order to appropriate and alter them. And thirdly, with Ars Doom, a new material entered the system of art, namely the video game as a new artistic material. Ars Doom is not the only computer game modification that doubles the space in which it is exhibited and simulates it within its structures. Another example is the series Museum Meltdown by Palle Thorsson and Tobias Bernstrup from 1996 to 1999. That's Peter again. And here we have Ars Doom. We have Museum Meltdown, again a brutal take on the museum as an institution. Museum Meltdown is available in three different versions and represents three different museums that the recipients force their way into during the game. Accordingly, each version has been exhibited in the museum it depicts. The first version from 1996 is a modification of the game Duke Nukem 3D, and it represents a model of the Arken Museum of Modern Art in Copenhagen. The last one here is the Moderna Museet in Stockholm. It's a Half-Life modification. It was made especially for the museum. And what's rather cute, in this third version, it is possible, for example, to smash the large glass by Marcel Duchamp with a crowbar. The map of the Stockholm Museum not only depicts the rooms of the museum, but also the hanging and the placement of the artworks as they can be seen in the real space of the museum. Thus, it is possible to actually be in the rooms of the museum as a recipient while within the computer game One seems to walk through the mapped rooms and destroy the artworks that are also present in the physical space. Here's the large glass, which is a famous piece by Marcel Duchamp, and you can smash it with a crowbar. The crowbar, of course, for video game connoisseurs, you know it, is a very famous weapon from Half-Life 2. There are many other examples of computer game modifications in which museums of exhibition spaces are recreated. The Quake map No Room Gallery, for example, by Imre Oswald and Florian Mussa, is a replica of the annex of the Hamburg Kunsthalle. Chris Riley's series Everything I Do Is Art, But Nothing I Do Makes Any Difference is for the game Half-Life 2, and it includes a replica of the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. And in Hunter Jonathan's work, Jeff Koons Must Die, works of art by Jeff Koons can be destroyed. Computer game modifications in which exhibition spaces are recreated can be described as a subcategory of artistic access to computer games. First-person shooters, namely whose scenery is moved directly into the operating system of art, are adapted to it. Starting from Ars Doom, one colleague of mine, Tilman Baumgärtel, identifies a certain tradition of using computer games as a commentary on the art world and its institutions. The works evoke a critical, brutal and aggressive impetus towards the traditional art represented by institutions. One possible interpretation, of course, is that the iconoclastic gestures suggest a hierarchy of artistic media and radically challenge the supremacy of traditional artistic forms of expression and their institutional representation and preservation by introducing a new medium that is capable of artistic expression also. In 1991, Jeffrey Shaw created this seminal piece, The Virtual Museum. And this virtual museum is a three-dimensional computer-generated museum space comprising an immaterial constellation of rooms and exhibits. A circular, motorized, rotating platform holds a large video projection monitor, a computer, and a chair from which the viewer interactively controls her journey through the virtual museum. Forwards and backwards movement of the chair cause corresponding motion by the viewer through the virtual museum space represented on the screen. Turning the chair produces a rotation of this virtual image space and also a synchronous physical rotation of the platform. The virtual museum is made up of five rooms that have the same appearance as the real rooms in which the installation is located. This establishes an augmented conjunction of the real and virtual spaces, as well as a paradoxical conjunction of the real and the virtual. To make this explicit, the first virtual room shows a replicated representation of the installation itself. So, when first seated, the viewer faces both the real and virtual monitor screens, and these real and virtual realities are exactly aligned. Then, as the viewer starts to travel through the virtual museum, she, in effect, transports herself out of this chair and sees the represented installation with its vacated chair as an object outside of her virtual point of view. This is a picture from the opening of ZKM's first dedicated video game exhibition called Welt der Spiele, World of Games, in 1997. As you might know, that I myself completely redesigned Welt der Spiele when I was working at ZKM, and it became the now present ZKM gameplay. And in this first version, there was this beautiful installation called Labyrinthos. It must be here somewhere, and I don't know, in the somewhere, some parts of it may be still there. The installation Labyrinthos was a ZKM production, and it was based on a historical computer game called Midi Maze. The players had to track each other down in a labyrinth that imitated the architecture of the real media museum of that time. Thus, the game included a complete model of ZKM's media museum in 3D. Players could roam freely in the virtual museum space, and up to 8 players could sit together at this gigantic console, which was a multiplayer shooter for this time in the museum. Very peculiar thing, and I couldn't find it when I recurated the world of games. Now we jump into today. Today, the immaterial display from the project Beyond Matter is a key installation in the exhibition that we are closing today, Matter, Non-Matter, and Antimatter. It allows visitors to move around the space, to come into contact with the numerous artifacts in two fundamentally different digital models of the historical exhibitions Iconoclash and Les Immatérieux. The creation of an exhibition through an immaterial constellation on a digital display has, of course, as we have seen, been tested by Jeffrey Shaw and by other video game artists before. The Virtual Museum from 1999 serves, of course, as an important reference for the current project. The immaterial display consists of a curved screen that serves as a display. The installation is equipped with a driver's seat, a term Shaw used to describe this kind of chair equipped with a controller in which a self-regulating joystick provides extensive accessibility. And that, of course, draws heavily from concepts tested and elaborated in the field of video games and video game culture, and is influenced by 80s arcade culture. In this immaterial display, the categories of games as exhibits and games as exhibitions are combined. To summarize, in the museum and exhibition context, the influence of video games are much more noticeable than it's apparent at first glance. Their techniques, dispositives, controls, conventions, and content have inscribed themselves in artworks as well as in museums and exhibitions themselves. Thank you.